Coffee. Morning.
Good morning, babe.
And there's Ross. Can you please go ahead and scrape off my car? Where are we going to order today? You
garage. Of course.
I asked nicely. I'm going to answer you nicely. It's all for me to, you know. Why is it that you never bought your socks? Isn't it easier to just reach in and grab a pair of socks every morning?
Got one. All set. Hey, I got my methods.
Yeah, strange methods.
Hey, remember to scrape your car now.
Thank you. How are you feeling?
Oh, got a headache.
Did you say something for it?
Well, I want to have something in my stomach.
Want to make some toast?
Do we got English muffins?
Yeah, I'm going to your mom's apple pie jam.
Sweet. Hey. Who called last night?
Thought you were sleeping.
I was, but I remember the phone ringing.
It was your Uncle Paul. I didn't want to wake you. You haven't been sleeping well.
You mean Uncle Lawyer? Should let the machine answer it.
He means well.
Paul may be famine, but he gets paid to mean well. Now I don't have anything to do with it.
Charles is in the hospital again. I guess he got a jump last night outside out. He's pretty banged up.
What is Paul calling me?
Charlie wants me to.
Probably wants money.
I don't know. Paul said Charlie's not scared. Really scared.
He should be scared. Every time he gets cash in his wallet, he heads on down to Enright's, thinking he's John Wayne. 3 days later, he's broke, in the gutter, wondering where all his friends went. And I'm not cleaning up any more of his messes.
He needs help.
You know how many times you've been through this? Too many, and he still won't change. I must be enabling him. I must be.
I know you're right. It just catches me off guard. It's like a recurring nightmare. You think it's gone, and then you get a call in the middle of the night.
Gotta let this go.
I can't help it. It's inconceivable to me that a person could fall so far. He's totally been out of his life. His grandchildren. He's broken every single promise he's ever made, including the ones he made to himself. His whole life is a broken promise. I guess it's just hard for me to believe that there's nothing left to stay sober for. They just give up.
People give up all the time.
And maybe, but he's your father.
It's not my father anymore. My father's gone, he's not coming back. That's why I call him Charlie. Doesn't feel right to call him Dad anymore. I mean, you only get a brief glimpse of what kind of man he really was. I mean, when we were growing up, sure, he was always good time Charlie, but he used to care. He'd tell me how to ride a bike. He'd let me take apart radios and telephones to see how they work. He took me to the Adirondacks. When we were growing up, the kid's neighbor came to our house to hang out. You know how hard it is for him to hold down a job? When we were growing up, he had two jobs he hated, just to give us all the extra things we wanted. But then, when Grandpa died, things changed. Grandpa was always making sure Charlie kept his appointments, going to work, went to church. I think Charlie bailed him out of a lot of trouble, too. Now he expects us to pick up where Grandpa left off? Ah, I don't think so. I'm not gonna pick him up downtown, lend him a few bucks, help him get his car to the impound again, and I cannot go see him in the hospital today. You gotta be on board. If he senses weakness in you, he'll use you to get back on the street.
I know, you're right. It just makes me feel sick. It's hard to let someone hurt like that and not try to help.
It's not as hard as it used to be. I used to think I could help him. I used to care. But now I know the best thing I can do for him is leave him alone.
It's so sad. What are we supposed to do now?
What we can do. Move on. Eat breakfast. Go to work. Try hard. Live our life. Love each other.
So, should I call Paul back and let him know that comes to the hospital?
Don't worry anymore. I'll call him.
$20.
And where's your money?
You know, if I had any, I wouldn't be asking for nothing.
I don't know why you're getting smart. You won't be broke.
Are you gonna let me borrow the money or what?
No, I don't. What happened to your check?
Things ain't cheap, Skyler. Are you gonna give me the money or what?
Yes or no? You know I'm struggling with this baby and you can't let me hold $20? Nobody told you gonna get pregnant. Listen, when I told you I was pregnant, we knew times were gonna get hard. But you made me feel like you were gonna have my back, cause that's what sisters do. Listen, it's not even really about the money. Sometimes I just feel like you take advantage of me. Like, remember last week when you asked me to watch Little Man so you could go out with, what's his name? David? Yeah, him, David. I left you some cash because I know you need some you time, but you didn't come home till 3 in the morning. And then when you did come home, you told me you didn't even have a good time. But and you, I was still up with the baby while you were passed out in my bed.
But you said you would watch him.
Yeah, and I did. I didn't have a time to watch him. And you know that. He's the sweetest baby in the world. But look, the thing is, I'm helping you out the best way I can, with what I can. And it seems like you're not getting what the rest of us are getting.
Oh yeah? And what's that?
That we, meaning all of us have to be here for each other. Have each other back, know that no matter what, we're gonna be here for each other. And you, you have to learn that you're the mother of this baby, and he comes first.
He does come first. Do you think I wanna be stuck at home all day? I love this baby, but it's not ever about me anymore. Like, what happened on my birthday? Everything was about the baby. He got a new car seat, 3 new outfits, a pile of Max and Ruby DVDs, Nikes, diapers and wipers. And what did I get?
You told us to get stuff for the baby.
A piece of cake, that's it. Now listen, if it's a problem.
What's going on in here? Ain't this supposed to be getting ready for school?
Yeah, but.
But nothing. Why are you two in here adding so early in the morning? You're gonna wake the little ones, and you know how they get in the morning time.
It's nothing, Ma.
Don't tell me that. Do I look like I was born yesterday?
I just wanted to borrow some.
And what you need money for? I hope you don't be running around with that boy I hear you with, buying him things.
No, man.
Either way, you shouldn't be arguing like you do. You two are sisters. What's gonna happen when you leave each other? You're supposed to take care of each other and not snap at each other like crocodiles.
Yeah, Mom. We know.
Then act that way. You know I had you beaten when I was 17?
Yeah, you don't have to hear the story.
No? It seems like I have to tell the story again because you're obviously not getting it. I was the youngest in my family, but the first to have children. Everybody went crazy when they found out that I was pregnant. Like they didn't think it was possible. But I was always out late, doing what I want, when I wanted. Nobody tried to stop me, well, except for Uncle Ty. Caught me at some grown-up parties, drinking and smoking. Almost killed the guy I was with, and nearly broke my leg, dragging me by his out the door. When I finally started to show, nobody wanted to talk to me about it. You know, I had no idea what I was supposed to do. Mother didn't speak to me for weeks. My so-called friends started acting shady. And my sisters could care less about what I did as long as I stayed out of their way. I was so alone and scared to death of what was gonna happen. Had no clue what I was supposed to do. Then one day, Mama came up to me. She sat me down like I did when I found out about the tumor and said, listen, baby, it's you and me. She said she'd pray on it and that we're gonna raise this child here. And we did. You see, Mama taught me there's nothing stronger than women working together. There's nothing stronger than family. Now we all have each other, and we've got to stick together. God knows there are enough things in this world to put us down. You do it for yourself and do it for the little man with me. He's our child. Now, stop acting like you do and get ready for the day.
Come on, just take it. I gotta get ready for school.
Thanks, Dad.
No matter what I do.
Yo, what's up? Not much. You want me to play? I got my own problem. I know. Green everything. I don't see why you get worked up over her. She old news. You know you get worked up on Skylar.
I got you, alright. Yo, wait up. I got a call from my mom, though. Yo, yeah, mom. It's on the Xbox, on the TV stand. Yeah, I found the money. I got everything I need. Alright, thanks. Love you.
Yo, speaking of Xbox, why was y'all Xbox Live last night?
Because you thinking things over.
What over?
I've been hearing things on Facebook. I just don't know what to do.
Well, a couple months ago, you seemed happy. Don't let this get to your head.
Alright, I got you, though.
Yo, did you see the new girl?
Ugh, don't get me started.
She's a
ugly.
Yo, she looked more like a mule, though.
I saved you, right? You ain't messing with that.
Well, alright. See you next period.
I got you, though. Yo, yo, you did the homework?
Oh, I forgot. You know what chapter you gotta do?
Wait, isn't it chapter 2? No, wait, they're not chapters, they're acts. Act 2.
Scene 3.
Yeah, I got you. Don't we have, like, a test 2?
Yeah, I think so.
You didn't give me the answer, right?
I got you.
You got me, though?
All right.
All right, see you.
See you next period.
Yo, don't be skipping.
All right.
All right, got you.
Did you say, oh, you're breaking up on me? knowing that at this stage of my life that I would have lived very comfortably. But I'm somewhat concerned because I sense the lacking of some zeal for academic success for some of our students. This does have me somewhat concerned. You know, I can recall coming up in the South Bronx and Fort Apache Bronx, that I too had some role models. And they were John Fitzgerald Kennedy, Dr. Martin Luther King, Stokely Carmichael, and Malcolm X. You know, these individuals, they were all on the same thread for equality for the poor. And the common thing between them is they were working for the most disenfranchised, trying to help everyone improve the quality of their life. So today, I want to carry that same banner for them. And I look back over time and I see that the Soviet Union had launched a satellite, the first satellite to ever orbit the planet. It was called Sputnik. And I recall that everyone was frightened to death, gazing at the starlit skies, waiting for this thing to fall out of the sky, and it was doomed. President John Fitzgerald Kennedy came on the air, and he said, "Do not miss dismay. We will be successful. That although the space age has begun, and the Cold World has Cold War has begun, we will be successful." He said, "I pledge to you that by the end of this decade, we will have a man on the moon." And lo and behold, his pledge became a reality. And I believe it was September of 69 that the Apollo landed on the lunar surface of the moon, Apollo 8. And it landed, and the first human being, an American, laid first foot on the moon. What a wonderful, magnificent time this was, because the Americans had demonstrated their superior abilities to send a crew to the moon, right on the lunar surface. This was big doings. You know, and I was working at an architectural firm, and I was sitting back and I was wondering, I was like, you know, one day I'd like to have some kids. One day I would like for them to be really productive, maybe inventors. So I decided that although my idols, the ones that I had looked up to, three of the four of those gentlemen had been assassinated, that I was not going to allow their death, their untimely death, to extinguish the flames of their hope that poor people will be rich, that those who are disenfranchised will grow and come to learn new and great things. And so I too took on that challenge to become several different things, and here I am today with you. This is just one leg of my journey, but you know, it's an important leg, because I too have managed to encourage my wife, my sons, and my daughters to become the best that they could possibly be. That although we are in times of hard economics, that they too have made great accomplishments. And I am very proud that they're involved in business, and finance, and real estate, and human services. It's a wonderful thing. Now here we are, 2011. The first African-American president of the United States of America, Barack Obama. What a wonderful man. And I stand back and I go, oh my God, look at what he has inherited. Financial doom, turmoil, oil spills, the stock market.
Gas.
But you know, he's holding true. And you know, I'm optimistic that those resources that are needed for your education, for you to become that productive member and go to that next level will be available to you as well. Hold on. Oh, time to start letting the kids in. Enter two, excuse me. Good to see you. Come on in.
Hey, Circle. How are you?
Good to see you. Come on in.
But he didn't come this morning because we had an argument about him buying our son's Pampers this week.
So I had to catch the 2 Thurston bus from home to downtown. Then get on the 5 to take my son to Child's Play daycare. Then catch another bus back downtown to get on the 8 Browncroft bus to school. I'm so aggravated right now, my day hasn't even started. And these scanners, all they do is invade your privacy and make you even later for class. The only thing I actually do like about them is that they keep a safer environment, and sometimes that isn't even guaranteed. People still sleep obvious in the school. Like the other day, a boy right in front of me had a pocket knife stuffed in the side of his shoe. That's just stupid. Then he had the nerve to say he didn't know it was there. I understand that this is a school and that we all have to be treated fairly. I just wish that being treated fairly didn't mean being treated like criminals. Look at me. What am I possibly going to bring to school to harm myself or others? I mean, come on. I have a 1-year-old son waiting for me to come home. I don't have time to be getting in trouble or going to jail. You don't believe me? Here's what I did yesterday. I had to go to school at 7:30 in the morning. I have a total of 7 classes. At lunchtime, I go work in the library. After school, I have to work. I work at Wegmans making $8.25 an hour. I've been there for 2 years now. When I get home, it's already 10 o'clock. So I give my mom a break from Jordan's because she's had him since he's been home from daycare. When I finally get Jordan to go to sleep, I have homework to do. When I finish with my homework, it's already going on 1 in the morning, so I maybe have 3 or 4 hours of sleep until I have to get back up and do it again. My mom, she's been there since my son was born. She tries her best to do as much as she can, but I have to remember, she has a life too. She didn't have this baby, I did. So it's my responsibility to take care of her. So clearly, I don't have a social life. I barely get to hang out with friends or go places. I have no time. It's always work, school, and being a mother. I don't have a boyfriend. I don't even have time to look at boys. I don't know, just sometimes I feel so lonely. I just want to be able to talk to someone, someone that would just sit there and listen. Someone that would set me for me. I just want to be able to live life.
Tell us what happens in Romeo and Juliet.
I saw the movie. Are we gonna watch it? Can you
question you literally heard him have for you, he's mad for it.
Yes, yes, Miss Maria, he is dreaming. But who knows the story? What happens to Romeo and Juliet?
I saw a movie too. It was kind of weird. These two kids fall in love at this party, and then some stuff goes down. I don't remember exactly what happens, but then some people get killed.
Oh yeah, I did see that. Yo, that guy's saying with blood,
son. Two teenagers who fall in love, secretly get married, and then they kill themselves.
So stupid.
Star is exactly right. Two teenagers, a girl 13 and a boy, male the same age, meet at a party. They immediately fall for each other. They kiss on the lips within 3 minutes, and just days later, they marry. Mm. 2 days after that, the damaged arms, suicide.
Yeah, that part was stupid too.
What a wait, you're so boring.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
You are. What? They was only 13?
Yes, just 13. Now, I want everyone to ask yourself something. You're all around the age of the two heroes, Romeo and Juliet. So I think your answer to this would be better than mine. Love at first sight. Is it possible?
I think so. No, I mean, I think people can fall for each other at first sight, then later fall in love, you know?
I'm not sure what you mean. Can you explain a bit more? Is it possible? Can people love each other upon first sight?
Can I answer?
We'll get to you next, Brianna. Sean, you have thought a bit more.
I'm not speaking from real life here, but if I went to a party, met a girl, fell in love, and married her, wouldn't that be love at first sight? Everything that happened all happens from the first meeting.
Teenagers can love, but most have no clue.
Okay, Skylar, go on. We're talking about whether or not love at first sight is possible.
Love's at first sight, definitely. Yeah. But love is rare.
You mean romantic love?
Yeah, that love you've been talking about. That kind of love is rare. And I see it in most movies, and it's making some scenes fake to be true, kind of like a joke.
Interesting. We'll come back to the realness of the love in just a moment. Later on, I'll need you to tell me whether or not the love is a joke. But for now, I want to shift back to something Robin said earlier. She said the lovers are pretty stupid. Who kill themselves, is that correct?
Can we just read Miss Yadula too much?
Word. Hang in there, Ben. Because we have a chance to be short. Robin, what do you think?
Anyways, they were stupid for the whole thing.
Stupid. Keep this in mind throughout our reading. Were Romeo and Juliet stupid or foolish? Did they make foolish decisions to love, to marry, to die? It's a theme we will return to again and again in the next few weeks.
Suicide is stupid. Why would you want to kill yourself?
I agree. Suicide makes no sense to us living. But I think Shakespeare was trying to make a different point here.
Let us read, please. No one wants to talk about it anymore.
I do. Now, Shakespeare also shows us another way to look at this tragedy. Faith. Who knows what faith is?
No one cares.
Don't get snappy.
Just being honest.
Well, your honesty can sometimes be cruel, Mary. Please give it a try.
Fate is like destiny. Everyone is on their own path in life, that kind of stuff.
Yes, we are all on our own path in life. Throughout the play, Romeo fully believes that he's either fated to love Juliet or die by his own hand. Juliet, too. You will see that they both believe that death is the only alternative to love. It is a shadow that is cast in an opening monologue and lingers on until the prince delivers his final remarks 2.5 hours later. Now, Brianna, will you please read the monologue on page 7?
You already did this part.
Yes, Ms. Raymond.
Look at you, you were talking too much. We forgot.
Come on, just read.
Fine. You all gonna go to like a diggity. Terrible movie that I seen. Angie Girl drinks new movie. Silver blood makes silver. Miss, what does any other genre mean? I'm not reading anymore.
That was fine, Brianna. You just stopped at a good place. You just outlined some major events and why.
Miss, what good is it if I have no idea what I'm reading? This is too much and it doesn't make any sense.
I know it seems like a lot right now, but that
means— Miss, no one's gonna read this.
Let her think it's finished and just stop acting like you're speaking for everyone.
Ooh. Ooh.
Yeah. and that's final. Hey, give me my phone back. You can't touch my stuff. Here. Really gotta stop doing so much, miss. No. She's wrong. Clearly not doing enough around here. We've been together too long for us to activate each other. It's February, and it's freezing cold outside these windows. Why can't we be a little warm to each other here?
She's full of drama, miss.
I know, that's why we need her. It's freezing cold outside these windows. What? How is it even cold in here?
Oh, yeah, dude. Shoot that center. I bet you wish you did and got hit with that snowball. He's looking really nice looking at you, too.
Well, I know he's looking at you.
I don't know, he a little weird. Always writing those raps on his phone talking about, I'm obsessed with you, girl.
I think it's cute. At least not acting like these other dudes out here trying to act all hard and what, not getting at anything they see. To Shana's eye, it was kind of sad how Brianna dissed him after break. Well, at least he called him an object of affection.
We were so tight in middle school, Deshauna and Brianna were like official. Always together like hot sauce and chicken. But I don't even know who she is anymore. She always angry and I didn't even do nothing.
Well, Deshauna's back now, he into you. That's enough. You know how real you are. Brianna just to herself. That's what she gets for being promiscuous. And now she has to live with it. And if I was her, I'd just change schools because she's nasty. And everybody knows it.
Promiscuous? How do you know what they're saying is true, though? We're always pointing fingers at females and this voice will make us look bad.
Well, you know me, I'm just trying to spread the word because she was the one liking me to rule Leo.
You just mad because you can't get with Leo. Oh my god, Bobby, you got to stop saying that. I'm sitting right here.
Can you talk right now?
I love you, girl, but you need to be texting me all day. I really don't care that the chicken looks nasty. I see every day.
Oh my god, you can let that on Facebook. Don't hate. Anyways, back to the subject. I really don't care how we're in between Deshauna and Brianna. She mad shady, yo. And I don't even care about Leo. That looked bad. And now she's trying to eat with John? Man, Deshauna and his homeboys are passing around like dip on a Super Bowl Sunday. I seen them on Facebook yesterday. Huh.
But how do you know they're saying it's true? You know how people be running on Facebook?
Well, she's not guilty, then why is she acting this way?
I don't know, maybe she just over it. What is your problem?
What's my problem? Why are you trying to take my man?
He ain't your man no more.
Who's even talking to you?
I don't care.
Oh, promiscuous? Oh, sweetheart, you got it twisted. You're the one going on Facebook rumors saying that Skyler want to get out of my name.
Excuse me? I don't text him, he texts me. I don't even talk to him.
That's not what your girl said on Facebook. Trying to see how it feels. Your so-called friend talking behind your back. We used to be best friends, Skylar. Now you're friends with these girls and you don't want to stick up for me?
Don't listen to anything she says, Skylar. She's like every other girl in the world. Typical. A statistic.
You know what, Brian? I'm getting tired of you and your mouth.
I don't care if she behaves well. I don't know what to girls.
Who are you, Cuffin?
You can't be jealous. You gotta be jealous of.
I love a woman who speaks her mind, but lately, you've just been talking too much, and I don't think you're ready to be with anybody.
I am. I'll show you.
Okay. I am ready for love. Why are you hiding from me? I quickly give my freedom to be held in your captivity. I am ready for love, all of the joys of pain, and all the time that it takes just to stay in your good grace. Then watch what you ask for, 'cause you might receive. But if you ask me tomorrow, I say the same thing.
Just me. Things that hold chemicals together in solids, liquids,
Even gases?
Yo, Wesley, you know how you gave me these MPs, right?
Why are you trying to embarrass me, man? I can't sit next to them.
Excellent demonstration, Mr. Westall. Now then, yesterday we discussed ions, if you can remember. So, can anyone tell me what happens between a positive and a negative ion?
Hey,
what's
an ion?
It's like you're
sure
how to think.
Positive and negative ions attract each other.
OMG, like Romeo and Juliet.
Oh my gosh, girl, he don't want you.
Very good, Skylar. I see you brought your thinking cap. And ladies, please. Thank you. Now, today, you're going to use that knowledge of ions and see how it, that's what I'm looking for, how it, what it has to do with what we're working with. Lead nitrate and sodium iodide. Wait a minute, oops, I should get the solids. Okay, here we go. All right, in this vial is the lead iodide. And in this vial, sodium nitrate. Now then, I selected these two compounds because the ending result of their bond is quite visually pleasing.
So, Leo, your sister's visually pleasing, man.
Your mama thinks I'm visually pleasing.
Lead, isn't that stuff poisonous?
Indeed it is. And gentlemen, should I please stick to the chemistry between the elements and not your mothers? Now then, in this vial, we have little tiny positive lead ions.
Oh, I think my cousin has lead poisoning.
Indeed, as I said, lead is quite poisonous. It is commonly found in paint. Anyways, where was I? Oh, correct, okay. Lead, iodide. I mean, lead nitrate. The lead ions are bound together with the little negative nitrate ions, which is an element commonly found in foods to preserve them.
Oh, like hot dogs.
Indeed, Mr. Westwood, indeed, like hot dogs. And in this vial, I have the sodium iodide. Sodium, as you all know, is found in common table salt. And the iodide, I'm sure many of you have been in contact with it before, if you've ever given blood. Does anybody here give blood?
Yeah. No. Oh, I'm afraid they're not gonna get my blood back, so I don't ever try to do that stuff.
Are you ready for the experiment? I'm going to combine the two in their solid state. Stand back! Jeez, I better stand back too. Just add the sodium iodide, and now prepare to enter the lead nitrate. Why nothing has happened? Whoa! You're really on a roll here, Skylar! Yes! The fact that they're both in their solid state certainly does have to do with why they did not bond. It's clearly not the right environment for any new bonds to form. But perhaps, if we were to change their environments by adding a little H2O, or water as it's called in non-chemistry language. We all know what salt does in water, correct?
It's dissolved. The chemicals are still there, but we just can't see them in those
lines. Exactly. Now then, since It takes time to dissolve them. I brought some pre-dissolved elements of the sodium iodide and the lead nitrate, and shall now combine them. Are you ready? You watching the back? Ready? Even more, because I know exactly what is going on. Now then, this yellow liquid here is lead iodide. Little tiny lead ions, which were previously bound to the nitrate ions, are now combined with little negative iodide ions. The bond between the two is very strong, stronger than the bonds they previously were. What I'm trying to say is that the connection with the lead and the iodide is much greater than the elements they were previously bound to.
So you mean you can't separate them and put them back in their original solid form?
Exactly! I cannot! You cannot! If I were to even attempt it, I would live out my entire life here in this lab! Never, and I mean never, see the light of day again, unless I were to open a window, of course. However, this bond is nearly impossible to get the yellow solid broken down to any other form.
So they're not meant to be together?
It's not your fate.
Oh my gosh. You're right here, y'all. Mental.
They're not meant to be together. The connection between the lead and the iodide is far too great to separate.
Bonds. It's what it's all about. My mom, my sister, my nephew, and Brianna. Lead iodide. We are lead iodide. We cannot be separated. The perfect conditions have bound us together, and nothing can break us apart. No guy, no Facebook posts, no stupid birds screaming in our ears, nothing.
Now then, if you will all record your final observations and begin to clean up your stations.
Thank you.
usually get tired around the middle of the week, but I still work hard at those jobs. I work hard because I have to help support my family, make sure my children have everything they need. See, I like working at ASI. It gives me a chance to get back to my middle school, you know? My alma mater. See, we custodians at Rochester City School District, we have a motto. The motto is that we are support staff that supports students. See myself, I hold this motto in high regards, and I apply to my job every day. One thing I like about working at ASI is knowing that there are many students that are kind and respectful that walk these halls and the stage every day. There's not one day that I can remember that someone has not walked past me without saying, excuse me or pardon me as I sweep the floors or dust mop. Believe it or not, these little gestures, they mean a lot to us all. About an hour, call my wife, check up on her, see what her status is. Call my other daughter, she lives with her mom nearby. Life is funny, see? It never works out how you first plan it. Yet, both my daughters, they go to the same school. It works out for them. Works out for me too. So I take comfort in what I do every day, knowing that what I do benefits other people. That's all I need, all the influence I need to ensure that life, as challenging as it is just fine.
I miss you too, girl. You better not miss me, though.
That is stupid.